We have another great, great panel coming up with Meredith Schmidt of Salesforce, David Chang, angel investor, Jennifer Mayer, 1776. This, ladies and gentlemen, is going to be a power-packed panel where I want your tweets to fly. I want your questions to fly. I want you to tag these people. They are ready to go already. I see them on my screen. So we're going to have an amazing time talking about leadership and more. When I was on the prep call with David, with Jennifer and Meredith, who I've worked with several times, I'm not joking. I was writing down notes in my little book here. So I can go on all day. So I want to save time for them. But Meredith, welcome. Thanks for being here today.
Thanks. It's great to see you. I'm surprised you're not wearing your signature orange sweater.
Yeah. You know, I figured I may try, Meredith, but today I figured, you know, go a little upscale. Does it look okay?
Yeah. I like it. The pocket square is on point.
Indeed. Thank you so much. David, thanks for being with us today, man. How are you? Thanks for taking the time to join us.
Happy to be here. I got my iron shirt here, and I'm actually propping up my laptop on the ironing board that I actually use to iron the shirt. And so it's a special day.
A guy in startup world, how else would it be? How else would it be?
Exactly. Yep.
Jennifer Mayer, 1776. How are you? Thanks for taking the time to be here and represent your peeps and community. Thank you, Jennifer.
Thank you for having me. I'm so excited to be here with you. Every time I talk to you, I feel re-energized, which I'm sure all the participants and listeners on the panel will as well.
Awesome. Awesome. We have a lot to dive into today to talk about, and I'm excited. I'm going to throw this first question and comment to you, Meredith, about flexible vision. But to set the stage, a few things we want to talk about today as you all are listening, taking notes, live tweeting, putting the comments out. Four key bullet points we'll try to get to, and I think it's going to help us. This whole event, this whole experience is about surviving the time we're in today and hopefully looking forward to better times and thriving. And as I've said before, those who've just come on, this sucks for all of us. Some people have had to close our business. I know Meredith has customers who've been jammed up. The 1776 community, not easy. David works with people, so we're all hurting. So we want to talk about the power, though, of having a flexible vision. Why is that important? What does it mean? Two, what are some communication strategies we can consider for small businesses? Jennifer and Dave are going to dive into some things they're seeing. We want to talk about the power of prioritization. And I think this is powerful because if you can't prioritize what you're doing, it's tough. And so I want to dive into this a bit as well with Meredith and Jen and David. And then I think we'll close pending the time we have in determination. As small business owners, obviously we have to be determined. We have to go on. But how do we do that? Sometimes, Meredith, it's hard. You know, life pulls at you. It's not easy, and you feel like just giving up. So let's start right at the top, Meredith. I'm going to throw this to you. This aspect, Meredith, I'll call it this concept, as it were, of flexible vision. We have our business plans. Things are going just fine. Meredith, things are coasting along or great. Then things change. Meredith, what does that mean to you? Help us unpack that.
Sure. I mean, no time in my entire career, and I'm sure many's entire life, has our priorities changed the way we're changing right now. We go through an exercise, takes us a month or 2 months at Salesforce. We call it the V2 Mom. We align on visions and values and methods and how we're going to achieve what we're going to achieve for the year. We finished that in February. 2 weeks later, this happened. This pandemic. And I will tell you, we threw that thing right out the window. So months of planning. And I think all of us feel that way now. You know, how do you switch? And I will tell you, it is all hands on deck for small business. And every team is embracing it across, not just, you know, my business unit with small business, but across Salesforce, really looking at how do we pivot? How do we pivot quickly? How do we get creative, changing the content we deliver, really thinking about not just our customers, but the entire small business community. You know, some of the offers we're doing, you know, with our product is free. It's really trying to help people connect. You know, our technology does a lot of great things, but right now it's really about helping small businesses understand how connections and how technology can help them in this time, which is actually a pivot to just our marketing. You know, I think about how we're approaching our own customers differently. You know, empathy, you know, how are they doing? We're not here to sell you something more right now. We're actually checking in. So I think it's really changed and humbled a lot of us on what matters the most in a time like this. And, you know, it's not the money. It's about surviving, like you said. I look at so many of the small businesses in my community who are pivoting. My local butcher, who I love the butcher. They now have fresh veggies and fresh fruit. They've got eggs. Mm. They've got bread. They've never had this before. I talked to them the other day. They've gone from 90 customers a day to 600 a day because of this pivot. And I just said to them, I'm like, please keep it, because I would love to not just stop there, you know, a couple times a week to pick up my chicken or my steak. I want to buy, you know, the produce there. So I think a lot of times like this, having that flexible vision and being able to pivot, I think we're going to, as small businesses, also see what we can do differently. And
yeah,
as we've had to react, you know, how does this become, you know, a hybrid business model in the future? How do you really change your business and prepare, hopefully not for another pandemic, but just a new way of connecting and working?
No, I think you're right, Meredith. And I think that's what I like learning from leaders like yourself who are in charge of larger companies. You know, again, Salesforce Essentials is designed for small businesses. And Meredith, I have to shout out Jake. You know who I'm talking about, Jake. Jacob, thank you for him on your team for helping us do this. So Jake, if you can hear me, I just want to thank you for pivoting and being nimble and expressing support for small businesses, even through the Survive and Thrive Summit. So thank you for that, Meredith. And I think you're right. It was amazing just being with you. It seemed like only a few months ago at Dreamforce. It's a little far away, but we were all together, and who knew this would happen? So thank you for that. David, I'm curious what you're seeing. David, you're an angel investor. You work with startups. This is your world. David, what have you gone through? I'd love to hear about that. And then what's your advice on this aspect of having a flexible vision? What does it mean to you, especially in light of what Meredith said?
Yeah, Meredith, your points are spot on. It's actually shocking to see how similar some of the challenges that some of the bigger businesses have within the SMB world and some of the smaller ones. And so the challenges that we saw in the early stage world was kind of twofold. You had some businesses that actually took off based on what they were doing in this particular environment, and others that completely cratered. And when it comes to like connecting your vision, and perhaps maybe I'll just offer an analogy that was really helpful for some of the startups that I've worked with, is that if you think about like where you want to go, let's just use the mountaineering analogy here. You got a summit, right? There's a place that you ultimately want to go to. You use that summit as a vision for where everyone should be pointing, right? So if you're a one-person company, 10-person company, 1,000-person company, doesn't matter. You have this vision, and that's a very, very big vision. And so that's something that you should absolutely keep in mind. And then the other thing is you want to know where your base camp is. So what's the next achievable step towards that summit that you can paint like a realistic, credible story around? And so those two things are super important for both big companies and little companies. And why it's so important is that although your pivots will change and where your base camp is and camp one will change, the path to the summit will never be the same thing. And so what's really helpful for small businesses, particularly as they talk to their customers and investors and external parties and partners and whoever they are, is that you want to make sure that other people know what your summit is and other people know what your base camp is. And the worst thing that you can do is only share one or the other. So you can imagine if I'm sharing my summit and you think it's my ultimate vision, it's like, well, too small, right? And the reverse is true, where, all right, this guy doesn't know what he's talking about. So make sure to communicate those two things in a short period of time. And this way you can ground your journey.
Yeah. Do you find, David, that's a common thing? And I'm going to turn to you, Jennifer, in a minute here. But do you find, David, that's common, is that the leader has one vision or one thought or one whatever they're doing, and going alone, maybe it hurts them because they think, you know, there's some miscommunication. They're wondering, why is everybody not with me? That's not that they didn't want to, what I'm hearing you say, David, but you just didn't communicate it and see who's on board. Does that make sense?
That always happens, which is why you want to have like junior folks in your team replay that vision. And I've been amazed at the number of times where either someone gets it 180 degrees off, where it's like, wow, I said one thing and you just played back something completely opposite, and you want to like dig into it, figure out why there's such a disconnect. And then the other beautiful thing that I've seen is that you sometimes have junior people that articulate it even better than you possibly could have yourself. And that's, you know, you're doing a great job as a leader.
Awesome. Hey, Jennifer, I'd like to give you a few minutes to tell us about 1776, and then I'd like your thoughts on flexible vision. But I think that it's amazing, Jennifer. I'm always surprised, as it were. I shouldn't be, Jen, but you know that people are like, hey, you don't know about these resources? No, never heard of it. So please help us understand what 1776 is, and then I'd love your thoughts on this aspect of vision, on what you're hearing either from those in your community or you as a leader, Jen, what you're going through and how that's working.
And I see it from both sides. We run incubator spaces. We have 8 locations across 5 states stretched out over the Northeast corridor. So I'm managing it within my own team, but then we're assisting thousands of our member companies with how they're going through this period as well. So one of the things that we talked about actually on an all hands meeting this morning, on an internal meeting, was how proud I was of our team to be really agile and flexible. And that end of March period, information was changing so quickly, government orders were coming down so quickly, we really had to pivot the entire business out of operating physical spaces into launching virtual programming. And our team was able to do that on a dime. And we see a light at the end of the tunnel now where we are going to be thinking about welcoming people back into our spaces, hopefully later this summer. And now we have to think about how are we transitioning back into that. And the team internally has been really great at just moving on a dime. And then we're working with all of our member companies. They're having to do the same thing. So we're connecting them with those resources that you mentioned. We have a really robust mentor network. They're doing programs and webinars. They're connecting individually and one-on-one with a lot of our companies to be able to get them to either pivot and work in direct response to the current pandemic, or some of the companies have to pivot because their business model that they had before isn't going to work in this new time. So it is having that startup mentality that you can move around, shift, and be really agile really quickly.
I love that, Jen. Thank you very much. And I think, Meredith, I want to go back to you with one other thing. And Meredith didn't ask me to do this. She probably doesn't want me to do it, but I'm still going to do it. I'd like to
spend... Oh, do it.
David's like, do it.
Oh, yeah.
But no, it's just to talk a little bit about essentials, Meredith. And I know you didn't ask me to do this. You probably don't want it done. It's not about the Salesforce meeting in this context, but I think it's important because David and Jen, I think there's a dividing line. I don't know how to even word this. I ask people all the time, like, what are you doing in this rough time? What I'm trying to say is, how are you keeping track of your customers? Can you go back and send an email? We have them in Excel. Excel's a great software product, great. But I think this aspect of CRM or database is important as well. So Meredith, just take 2 seconds and essentials. At a high level, what is it that we need to know about essentials? For those who don't have their customer information anywhere, can you give us a recap of why that's so important and passionate for you helping small businesses?
Yeah, so Essentials is the Salesforce's out-of-box CRM offering. This is really intended to connect with your customers. We can do it via, you can spin up a help center, 24-hour support. We can do mass emailing. You import all of your contacts. It's all right there. Everything's there. You manage it. All of the database, and it's a shared database, right? So you and your teams can get on and see all the data real-time together. And right now, it's free for 90 days. Anybody can sign up. We are doing webinars. We're doing office hours, really anything we can do to help you get started on Essentials. Any questions we have on how to use it, how to help you do your job, that is what we're doing. So out of the box, really relationships and connections with your customers. I think right now, connecting with your employees, your customers, and your vendors, suppliers, anybody, it's being able to keep it in one place and keep all that shared data together.
Yeah, no, I think it's very important. And again, whichever tool you use in this frame of reference, it's fine with me. There's great tools from Microsoft, great tools from Salesforce, great tools from a lot of different brands. But what hurts my heart so much is when they're like, I don't have a proper database of customers to hit one button and communicate with them. That jacks me up and breaks my little heart. So with that point, I want to turn to another topic that I think is really important. And we can go back, Meredith, David, and Jen, to any of these things, you know, when we get through these. But I think at a high level, it's good to lay out some ground points. And I was sneaking some looks at the Twitter chat exploding. It's exploding. It's firing up. So I'm amazed looking at the Survive Thrive hashtag. Keep that up. People are tagging you and saying, good job, Meredith. So keep that going as well. So communication strategies are important, are essential. And I think that a question, David, I'm often asked is, how do I communicate? I wouldn't say sell so much, but that's the essence. How do I sell? How do I communicate when people are hurting? David, I've had friends who passed away. So I want to acknowledge throughout this experience, this is a tough time for people. We're not glossing over that. But for those of us who can survive, who can thrive and go on, David, how do we, I don't know, sell our chapstick? How do we communicate a bit to our customers? What are your thoughts on doing that, especially when times are a bit not so cool? What do we do?
Yeah, I think maybe you can divide up communication externally and internally. And they're a little different, right? Externally, you got partners, you got customers. Sometimes if you're a small company and you're partnered with a bigger company, you can use that as an umbrella and sort of draft off of some of their messaging, right? And so that gives you a louder megaphone. When it comes to just communications in general, maybe this applies more internally, the recognition that you are vulnerable goes a long way. Like for many years in my early days, I always was sort of protective over, you know, can't show weakness, can't show failure. Right. And at some point you get comfortable enough in your skin, you're just like, you know what? Everyone fails. And it's such an interesting tipping point when you realize that you don't have all the answers. You are actually stronger when you recognize that. And the very first time that you offer that sort of vulnerability, it's super risky, right? It hurts to do. You're admitting something that you don't know. You may be telling someone and offering this weakness. And it goes such a long way to just connecting with people and sort of build that trust that on a communication standpoint, almost always offers up something first. 95% of the time, that'll be reciprocated.
Well, that is powerful. And I think dividing it is important because sometimes we may think, Jen, that the communication is all one, you know, is all one thing. But I think part of that is dividing it. What are you seeing, Jen, how you're doing it either at 1776, the leader you are, or what I always like learning is what other companies are doing. And you're an ambassador for a lot of other companies as well. So either way, how are you communicating and or what are you seeing in the market? Some best practices for that, Jen?
I agree with David, and it comes down to those two factors of internal and external, but in both of them, we've subscribed to an over-communicate model. So internally, we would have weekly leadership meetings and monthly all-hands meetings where our entire team would come together. We've switched them now where our leadership team meets every single morning because the environment is still changing pretty rapidly, and our all-hands mm-hmm. meetings are weekly now because we just need to keep the continuous communication cycle going. And there's emails and there's Slack and everything else going in between there, but we have to be in constant communication, like David was saying earlier, so there is that summit that's there and the base camp that you're looking at to make sure that there's communication within the entire team. And then with our members, which is our customer base, we're not looking at growth right now. We are looking at how we're going to be able to support people that are forced into entrepreneurship on the other side of this and building programs and resources that we're able to support them. But right now, people are focused on just the survive aspect. We want to be there when, yes. when they start thinking about how am I going to thrive on the other side of this. So we're not thinking about customer growth, but we are thinking about customer retention. So the members that we have now, which is what a lot of other companies can look at, are how are you serving your existing customer population and helping them get through these time periods? And it's really employing a partnership model to be able to yes. have those conversations. And that is also part of the over-communication strategy. Of course, we're sending the mass emails and they're going to different campuses, but we're checking in on every single one of our members individually, because we want to know how they're checking, and we employ a divide and conquer mentality within our team. And it takes a long time to get through that, but that's the most important aspect of how we will actually all thrive on the other side of that.
Yeah. And Jen, I think you're so right. I think if you can't show empathy, you don't care. As I think Meredith kind of hinted that her team is, you know, totally changing how they communicate. Game over. In 6 months, when all the things well, they're going to remember that. And to that point, just a few shout outs I'm seeing here in the team's chat. So thank you. I'll keep the Twitter chat going. Survive, thrive is the Twitter chat hashtag, but also in the Microsoft My Questions area. Send your comments, Meredith and David and Jen, some comments here. I think the CRM struck a thread. My English is bad, but anyways, something like that. Is that for business owners who have not had a good CRM solution and realize how important it is, where do we start? Meredith, I'll just slide that in. I know time is short, but I'd love for you to feel free to just give people a little start for where do we start? Because as I said, Meredith, a lot of small businesses don't have a proper CRM solution. So that's one. I'll remind you the question in a minute. Ellen Williams here from New York. She says Essentials from Salesforce is a great tool to get your data organized and potentially uncover trends. Ellen, thanks for being here. And YK Hanley says, we'll be looking into Essentials for newsletters. That is where I need to be. And then he asked a specific question about the email list. But you can just go to the Essentials team on Twitter, and they'll answer you real quick on that particular question. But Meredith, just take 2 seconds. Where do people start? The guy or gal who are like, you know what? I got all my business cards dumped in a bag, or I'm having them all typed in a word processor somewhere. Any just, I know it's hard because you don't know the scenario, but you know, if we had to start off, what do we do?
Yeah, I mean, first thing is importing your contacts into the database. Right. Once you get your contacts, everything is centered in CRM is around a contact. Right. That whole record is everything that you need around the customer. From there, you can create mass emails. You can create list views. You can create dashboards. But really, your first thing is getting your customer information into the system. So, you know, essentials.salesforce.com. Sign up for a trial. It's free. And again, we actually have a setup wizard. We tell you what to do first. It's all guided. And then when you get stuck, there's people. But find your contacts, find your list. Excel, super easy to import. So Hopefully you at least have it in Excel. And, you know, I think the power of a CRM tool is we're replacing a spreadsheet. A spreadsheet's not smart. A CRM tool is. And so how do you use, analytics? And, you know, we have something called Einstein, which is our AI. We do a lot of predictive stuff. So start with getting your contacts and your data in.
Awesome. And David, Tammy Davis says, oh my gosh, David is speaking my language. I guess that's about a comment you said. Thank you, Meredith, for that. Meredith, I'm going to turn this next question as we move to kind of a third stage here about prioritization, which I do think is absolutely essential. And again, I hope as you guys are listening, you're tweeting out Jen Mayer of 1776. David, thank you for being here as well. You can find him on the Twitter chat and on our site, Meredith Schmidt, who's leading the Salesforce Essentials team. Meredith, about prioritization, I think that's so important. I, in my own little small business, this is Smart Hustle headquarters right here. You know, I've had to prioritize as well. Just what do I do first? South by Southwest for many of us geeks and others who've gone there. That was kind of my big memory. I was supposed to be there and all of a sudden it was done. So Meredith, my question to you is, personally, I'd love to hear it if you wish, and or as the leaders, you're leading your team, and or what you're hearing from your customers, this aspect of prioritization, there's so much to do, so much right. to do on any given right. day. How do we know where to start, Meredith? What do you do?
Right. Well, I answer Mark Benioff emails first. I figure those, there's a lot of text coming from it. There's a lot of ideas. So I do actually look at what's on fire, and I usually look top down. Personally, but I think as a small business owner and as just personally, I have a 10-month-old at home, right? So my first priority of the day is actually waking up with him and spending some time with him in the morning. He loves to watch my espresso coffee machine. Like that is just my number one priority personally. But I think across my team, right, we're doing the same thing Jen's doing. We're meeting daily now. We're meeting all hands weekly. You know, we're setting the priorities. We're over-communicating. I think David said it too. Over-communicating priorities, not just how we're feeling, but we're taking a very personal approach to this too. You know, and then how do we collaborate? How do we stay up to date? Again, I'm going to do another plug, not because we're not, and this is free. Salesforce has a collaboration tool called Quip. It is free for anybody who wants to use it through September. It is one of the best collaboration tools that we have personally. That's how we stay organized. There's to-do lists, there's tasks, there's collaboration and chatter within it. And it's really how we keep our team all connected together. But I will tell you, there's we think we know what's happening Monday morning, Monday afternoon, there's a text from somebody who says, go create a small business grant fund. Now that somebody was Mark and it was a great idea. And I'm super excited to tell everybody that we're launching a small business grant fund tomorrow, giving grants, $10,000 grants to small businesses. So,
that's
you know,
a big deal.
Things like that. It's a big deal. And I was so excited. Mark was like, go do something more. And I'm like, can I have money? You know, I think there's content, there's technology, but there's also money, right? A lot of small businesses just need the money to keep their employees paid, to keep their paid. That's what we're really trying to help. And this grant is not just for small Salesforce customers. It's for all small businesses. Granted, not every small business will get one, but it's the application process is open to all and available and live online tomorrow. And you can find it. But, you know, your priorities change. And I think you have to be flexible to go with it. But over communicating and collaborating in centralized documents, centralized places, be it a CRM system, be it a collaboration tool like Quip, there's a lot of ways to stay connected. And as long as everybody's in that boat at the same time, and I think, you know, it was said well, as long as the person, you're talking the same language, you're gonna actually execute. And so it's okay for priorities to shift and just to go with the flow. That's kind of how I do with it. But then at the end of the day, my priority is putting that little baby back down to bed. So kind of having my personal priority as well as work.
I love it. No, thank you so much for Meredith. And I think that is so, so important. Again, I want to keep in mind that I know there's a lot of questions about the PPP, Paycheck Protection Program, and all these kind of things. We're not talking about that today. There's a lot of other amazing organizations doing that. I'm sure maybe Jen has been having webinars up the wazoo and David. But point being is that don't forget the grants and other opportunities by other companies. And we're going to have Hello Alice, co-founder Elizabeth Gore, in a bit of time as well. So I want to turn, we have about 5 more minutes to go. Wow, time goes so fast when you're having a good time. But I hope the Twitter chat's going and keep your questions going. Jen, I'll turn to you first, this aspect of determination, grit, hard work. I think small businesses, the good ones, and there's only good ones, don't have to be told to work hard. But Jen, yourself, how do you keep going on? How do you keep determined? How do you keep your head down and go? And as always, what are you hearing from the community at 1776? Can you talk about this aspect of determination, the need to do it in times like now when it sucks, Jen? What do we do?
Good question for me, given I'm in Philadelphia and our Flyers mascot is gritty. So Philadelphia is usually synonymous with that grit and hardcore determination. I think that what you need coupled with that is passion and purpose. Mm. And that's what we see with a lot of the entrepreneurs that we work with. For some, this is a time of self-reflection. Am I still passionate about the project that I've been working on for years? This is going to keep going. This is a true test of whether you're passionate about it. And that's an internal check for us too. Are we still really passionate about serving the entrepreneurs and providing them with resources? And I could see that from the rallying of my team immediately, that they are dedicated to building the entrepreneurial ecosystems where we have campuses. And you can be determined to do a lot of things, but if that's not coupled with having true passion and purpose, the determination is just going to fall off. You have to really feel it in your soul, feel it in your core, believe in what you're doing. And that's what's going to keep you going every day, because it's tough. And this is a really tremendously difficult time. It's unprecedented. It's slightly surreal. This is, you know, hopefully a once in a lifetime experience that a lot of us will have. And to have a level of determination that those untapped levels that people have never really dived into before, you have to have a passion and a purpose for what you're doing, whether that's an entrepreneur working in a corporation or, of course, now working in the healthcare field.
No, that is important. David, what are you seeing this aspect of determination and passion and grit and moving on? I know you're, as an investor and other things that you're doing, you see probably both sides of this. But what are you seeing that we can do? And I know even when I was starting the Survive and Thrive Summit, it was tough. I had the idea. It was just like a landing page. So I'm like, Meredith and her team, what do you think? We'll get back to you. Yes. I'm like, yes. And went down the line.
Yeah, you got that big landing page now from your world headquarters. It's all good, right? It's you know, for the founders that I've spoken to, and I've sat on both sides of the table, both being an investor and also an entrepreneur, failed at some, succeeded at some. The determination thing is something that absolutely is a prerequisite to be able to move on. And it's really natural to feel overwhelmed, right? Any given day, you're going to hit all these obstacles, and taking action is the key thing that you need to be able to do. So whether you have built some interesting asset that's fantastic that you can deploy somewhere, that's great. You may have some unique skills. You should bring those to bear. Or you may have some unique access to a network of folks. All of those things are things that you can deploy. And especially as a small, medium business, you're more agile than everyone else. So you should use that to your advantage.
Yeah, I love it. It's powerful. Jen, determination, grit. I think you've covered this, but anything else you want to add on this aspect before we close out? We got about 2 more minutes to go. Anything else you want to add on this, Jen?
Yeah, I'll leave that. A friend of mine sent me an article this morning about transferring the mindset of endurance athletes to the world of entrepreneurship. And there's basically 4 principles. Every entrepreneur has a little bit of a intensity streak. Mine is that I love doing endurance races. And to me, it's always been a synonymous mindset, but it's about patience, pacing, process, and purpose. And we have to remember this is a marathon, not a sprint. The time period that we're in, it's been weeks for a lot of us now. It's going to be weeks more. And we have to just pace ourselves, be patient with ourselves and others to get through this, and then drive back to making sure that we have that purpose and passion.
All right. And Jen, what's the website address? Or 1776? I'm sure a lot of people need your services and help. What's the website address, or how should we find more information about what you're doing?
It's 1776, just like the year where revolutions begin. 1776.vc, Victor Charlie. And we have a ton of virtual programming that's open to the public, to our members and our non-members.
Got it. Meredith, I want to leave the final word with you. Meredith, you work with zillions of small business customers. You lead them. As you said, you're in the community. Any last 1 or 2 words, Meredith, that we need to hear from you, what we can learn from you, your team at Salesforce, at Essentials, to help us survive and help us thrive? I'll leave the last word with you.
You know, I would tell you I have the best job at Salesforce right now, and I think the entire team feels that way, right? The people we get to help and work with, this community is... you know, the most thriving community in the world is small business. And I think we're all just super proud to be a part of this. And I don't underestimate how fortunate we are to work at Salesforce. And we want to make sure we bring that back to the community. You know, we talk about business being a platform for change. We at Salesforce want to help small business, and we're doing everything we possibly can day and night to make it happen.
Awesome. Meredith, who leads small business and the Essentials team at Salesforce, thank you. David, angel investor and more, look David up as well. He has a resource of knowledge. Jen, 1776, thank you, the three of you, for being here and for sharing your insights. And Meredith, thank you for making Salesforce is a big part of this, supporter of the Survive and Thrive Conference. Thank you and your team for making this possible for us to do this. Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
Thanks, sir.
You're welcome. Thank you.